And it wouldn't be right. She don't get to come a lot, but she wouldn't be right. She got his back, stand up, amen. I appreciate her being with me, and I appreciate everybody from our church coming. They come and back us up and help us out, and I'm glad to be a stand up, everybody from the church. Amen. His son preaches too, Barney. You might want to get a hold of him. Amen. He'll do you a good job too. And they sing and preach. I had them out to church. And they love the Lord. Amen. And they care. But I want to preach to you a little bit tonight on Psalm 139. Psalm 139. Father, have your way tonight. We pray, God, that you just move in a mighty way. Lord, we pray that you would touch from the pulpit the very last pew of this place. I pray, God, that you search this preacher's heart. Father, if there's anything in my heart that would hinder your word from going forth, I ask you to take it out. Forgive me, Father, in the name of Jesus. Let my heart be in tune with your heart. Let my mind be in tune with your mind. Let my thoughts be in tune with your thoughts. Father, may your words flow through me tonight, this vessel of clay. Let it go upon ears ready to hear, hearts ready to receive. And Lord, we'll thank you and praise you and honor you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
Why do I exist? Why do you exist? You ever thought about that? There's been times in my life I said, Lord, I don't even know why I exist. I don't even know why I'm here. When I've run the strength of doing things to the world, I didn't care why I was here. I just wanted to live my life, do my own thing, live it up. And it took me one time running right face to face with a Nazarene named Jesus. Amen. And he told me I was lost. He told me I was going to hell. But he didn't stop there. He told me there's a way out. And he provided that way, and I thank the Lord that he did. Why do I exist? In other words, I usually don't write things up, but I wanted to tonight when I come up here. In order to know God's purpose for our lives, we can go to His Word. That's why you have 7 services a week. Because to know God's purpose in your life, you've got to go to the Word of God. If you treat people like we treat God, we wouldn't have no relationships out here. We wouldn't have nobody that loves us. Because we just go to them when we needed something. We just go to them when we got in trouble. We will never go to them in the good times and say, you know what? I just want to say I love you. I ain't asking for nothing. I just want to say thank you. I was telling somebody at work, now, I'm just plain, folks. I'm just plain. I can't help it. That's the way I am. I was telling somebody at work the other day, you ought to thank God every time you go to the bathroom. Stop going for about 2 weeks. You'll start realizing what a blessing it is to be able to do it. You start thinking about what God lets you do. When you get up in the morning, you put one foot in front of the other. Every nerve in your back, everything that you've abused over your life, God's had amazing grace on it. And He's touched you that you were able to walk across the floor. You're able to look, see where you're going. You're able to lift your hands up. And most folks don't know what a blessing it is to raise their hands up. And they won't give God praise and honor and glory for it. I want you to know something. On a Friday night, I used to sit out on the old street corner. And I'd drink my beer. And if I seen a buddy of mine across the parking lot, I didn't care who was between me or him. I'd let out, hey! He'd look at me and I'd raise that old beer up in the air. And I'd say, look here, boy. And then he'd raise his up in the air. What we was doing was praising the devil and giving him glory and giving him honor for what we was doing in the world. Friend, I want you to know something. If I give the devil 100%, I don't give God 200%. And if I raise one hand up for the devil, I want to put 2 up for God tonight and say, I exist to praise the Lord, to honor the Lord, to glorify God, give Him praise, give Him honor. How many of you woke up last night and told your heart to beat? How many of you woke up and taught yourself to breathe. You didn't do that. It was amazing grace that kept your heart beating. God watched over you when you didn't know it. People tell me, say, God don't care nothing about me. I said, He didn't care nothing about you. You've been dead a long time ago. He didn't care nothing about me. There'd be a gravestone in the cemetery with my name on it. Amen. Because I've been dead a long time ago. But it was grace that God gave me, unmerited favor, agape love. And we want to treat God like some toilet in the bathroom. And we'll go in there when we're having trouble or we're having a need. Friend, I want you to know I want Him to be first in my life, first in praise, first in honor, first in glory, giving Him thanks from the rising of the sun to the setting of the saint. The name of the Lord shall be praised. Amen. I'll tell you right now, if it wasn't God, you wouldn't exist.
Amen.
You wouldn't be here. So knowing our purpose in life is important for what? Folks, we need fulfillment. I don't care how tough you are here, everybody needs some fulfillment in their life. I'll tell you what, listen. You wouldn't went out there searching for drugs. You wouldn't went out there searching for all that junk you done if you wasn't looking for fulfillment from something. You're looking for something to fulfill a void in your life. And you keep looking. Look, math will get you up, friend. It'll keep you up a long time. But when you get down, you'll be down. I'm telling you, you'll be down lower than you ever been. And you go searching for some more of that stuff to get you back up. I praise God, I'm higher than ever been. And anybody was on meth. I'm higher than anybody was on cocaine. I'm higher than anybody was on any of that stuff on the street. When I got a hold of God, He lifted me up higher. And I've been high ever since. Amen. There's a fulfillment in my life that I couldn't find from Jack. I couldn't find from Crown. I couldn't find from Brother Bud. I couldn't find it from vodka. I couldn't find it from Jim Beam. I couldn't find it from marijuana. I couldn't find it from popping those pills. I needed something in my life. And I found it the day that I went to an altar and fell down before God and said, God, I'm a mess. And the reason I'm a mess, it's my fault. I've been doing this to myself. I've been looking for the wrong thing. But praise God, I've come to the right place tonight. And I'm ready to get that fulfillment in my life. We need fulfillment. And if we don't fulfill, listen, if we do not fulfill the purpose for which we are created, we will not have fulfillment in our heart. Now, why was you created? Serve God. Everybody talks about the kingdom of God. You know I'm part of the kingdom of God. If you've been saved, you're part of the kingdom of God. You are God's representation on this earth. You just ain't got promoted to the big kingdom yet, but you're still part of the kingdom of God. You have a backing of a kingdom that the devil knows he can't beat. You've got the backing of a kingdom that the demons flee, the devil surrenders, amen. I want to tell you something, and listen to me, if you don't get nothing else out of what I'm saying tonight, get this, you're not fighting for it. You're fighting from victory. You got to get that in your head, friend. I'm not fighting for victory. Victory's already been won. I'm fighting from victory. Amen. He won the victory on no rugged cross. Amen. On a hill, on a place called Golgotha. He fought. He said, "It is finished." What did he do? He looked right down the hill. He looked the devil in the face, and he said, "Boy, it's done for you. It's over with. I'll pay the price." What the Bible say he done? He descended. Before he ascended, he went down into the depths of the earth and the hell. He took the keys to death, hell, and the grave. But that devil is giving you such a problem, don't even have the keys to his own house. God took him away from him. That's why he's going to and fro in the earth, seeking who he may devour. Friend, he ain't going to devour me no more. I'm fighting from victory.
Yeah.
I already got it. Man, that's bottom of the seventh, 2 outs. I play softball, not baseball. I play baseball with me bottom of the ninth. I'm just 1 out away of getting there, friend. I want you to know something. We need fulfillment in our life. Every one of us, amen? Success. You know what success is? being successful. You know what failure is? Succeeding at the wrong thing. Huh? Somebody say amen, hold me one. Failure is succeeding at the wrong thing. Oh, I succeeded being a big man out on the street. I succeeded being a big man out in the world. Everybody knew who I was. Everybody knew my name. Listen, I worked one time at a jailhouse, and I see some of the biggest, baddest men on the street. They lock them up in that cell, and they turn into two-year-olds. They said, please let me out. I said, would you please just let me out? I don't want to send me out. I said, man, I can't. I felt sorry for them. And I see them out in the parking lot, and I thought they was mean. Man, everybody thought they was mean. But nobody seen them. Look, the worst thing you have to do is build yourself. And when you get locked up in a place that you have to build yourself, it's hard to do. Biggest, meanest man in the world got laid out on a cell tonight. Failure is succeeding at the wrong thing. Then you got to determine your priorities. Our priorities come from knowing our purpose. Your purpose. God didn't just bring you down to this place, set you in here and save you, just so you could get a graduation certificate and walk out of here and say, I'm delivered. I said, no, he didn't. You're here for a purpose, man. God has a purpose in your life. And if you really realize what that purpose is, you realize why the devil wants to kill you so bad. That's why the devil says, listen, you got to get back out on the street. You got to go see them old friends. Because he knows what you can be in God, and he wants you to be that. So he wants to what? Kill, steal, and destroy. That's what he wants to do for you. He wants to take the success. He wants you to believe that you can't do it. I can't live this way. I can't do this. I got news for you. I can't either. I can't live right. I can't. If I depend on me, I'll fail. I can't. That's why I got the Spirit of God living in me. I sold out. I died out. I give up on myself. I said, I can't do it no more. I give it to God. So how do I live right? God leading me, guiding me, directing me, and showing me what to do. It's important for us not only to know what God saved us from, but also what He saved us from. Every one of you in here has got a work God wants you to do. But I can't tell you what it is. It's up between you and God. But the enemy won't stop. The Lord said, my sheep hear my voice, but a stranger's voice, they don't listen to. So when somebody comes up and says, first I just feel like giving up, I don't think I can make it, I don't think I can go, I said, you've been listening to a strange voice. You've been listening to something that Jesus told you not to listen to. When you start listening to strange voices, you start doing strange things. How we think of God has as much to do with how we think of ourselves. You think you think of yourself? Do you? Let me tell you why I said that. Do you think you think of yourself? Do you? Most of the time, y'all think good of yourself all the time. Because God created you in His image. So if you don't think nothing of yourself, you don't think nothing of God. We've got a big thing in our churches that we think it's a failure to succeed. It's not a failure to succeed. God wants you to succeed. God wants to bless you. Didn't He say, I'll open up the windows of heaven, pour out blessings on you that you can't contain? God wants to bless you. Don't talk yourself out of what God wants for you. God knows all about me. Let's look. Psalm 139 and verse 1, the Bible says here, O Lord, Thou hast searched me and known me. Thou hast searched me and known me. God knows you better than I do. He knows your intentions. He knows your heart. He knows your mind. The Bible said, men look on the outer appearance. God looks on the heart. God knows which one of you in here want to succeed. And God knows who's just sitting here to go through the program. He knows that. It's up to you to say, God, I'm not here just to go through the program. I'm here to be delivered and set free because I know who the Son set free is free indeed. And I'm ready to be free in the Lord. Amen. God knows your conduct, friend. He said in 139, 2 or 3, thou knowest my narrow setting and my uprising. Thou understandest my thoughts before all. Thou compassest my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. God ever convict you? He knows me. If not, sometimes I might have to get out in left field. I told my wife the other day, the worst thing you can do, sir, to God, is get up with pride in your heart and say, I'll never do that. You must say, with God's help, I'll never do that. Because you keep talking about you'll never do it, you end up doing the very thing you say you won't do.
Amen.
So you got to put your trust in God and believe what God says and follow God and believe, amen, God knows your conversation, friend. He knows what you're talking about. Verse 4 said, for there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. That thing right there gets us in more trouble than anything else. Right there. God preached to us about it in the Bible. Well, he tells us right quick. We'd put a stern on an old boat, turn it this way and that way. We'd put a bridle on a horse and mount, make it go this way, but we can't tame this. Only God can do that. Let me tell you something. God's always with you. He's always with you. Psalm 39, 5 and 6. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thy hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. You know what Jeremiah said? Jeremiah said this. Let's look at Jeremiah just a minute. I like what he said. Jeremiah 23 and 24. He said here, he said, can any hide himself in secret places that I shall not see him? Saith the Lord, do not I feel heaven and earth? Saith the Lord, you can't go nowhere and get away from God. He sees you at where you're at. Jeremiah 23 and 24. He said, I can't go nowhere that you're not there, God. That's good. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll forsake you. I'll be with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. You know, death can't hide me from God. Death can't hide me from God. The devil says, kill yourself and get it all over with. Take your own life. You don't have to fight these battles no more. You don't have to go through what you're going through no more. Just kill yourself. You think death hides you from God? Psalm 139, 7 and 8. What the Bible said, whither shall I go from thy spirit? Whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. You can't get away from God. He said, where do you go? The distance can't hide you from God. Distance. I remember when I was running from God, God called me to preach him. I thought I'd run away from him. You know, I went to Bible college for 2 days. In Greenville, I run all the way to Valdosta, Georgia. Man, I thought God didn't live in Valdosta. Too hot for anybody to live in South Georgia, I thought. My sister lived down there, I run to her house. I got in her house, a phone ring, and it was Valdosta Pentecostal Holy Church preacher. He said, son, man, you need to go eat breakfast in the morning. I said, God, what are you doing? You got people everywhere. Every time I try to run from you, I run right into you. Every time I try to get away from you, there you are. See, he was showing me how much he loved me. Friend, when you fail, when you mess up, when you make a mistake, that's when you ought to run to that bull instead of running from it. That's when you ought to run to the altar instead of running from it. That's when you ought to fall on your knees and talk to God and believe what thus saith the Lord. And quit saying, well, God won't hear me. God knows I'm messed up. God finished with me. That's a lie. was that easy to give up? I told you I'd be buried somewhere. You give up on yourself more than God does. Let me ask you this. Somebody will answer me. How much power does the devil have over you? Somebody said that. Somebody else.
Only what you give him.
There you go. He has just the power that you give him. So let's say, what are you talking about, preacher? Okay. You ever went through a situation and you said, I can't take this no more. I'm about to lose my mind. I don't feel like I can do this no more. I give up. I'm throwing my hand. You're giving him power over you. You say, okay, I got to give up. I can't take it no more. I'm quitting. And the devil said, okay, you can do it. You can quit. I got confidence in you. You can quit. You started this whole thing. But when you stand up and say, get thee behind me, Satan, in the name of Jesus, I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. I am what I am by the grace of God. Amen. Come on now. When you start taking scripture that the Lord gives you, that's why it's so important for you to know the Word of God and believe what thus saith the Lord. Darkness don't hide you from God, friend. Psalm 139, 11 and 12 said, if I say surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be a light about me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both a light to thee. There ain't no darkness to God. He's the light. He knows us, friend. He knows us. And I want to tell you this. Not hold you too long tonight. Let me tell you something. I used to party at 4 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning. I'd go home, take a shower, and go to work Saturday morning. I'd be standing on my job still high on the kite. Why is it when we get to church, we think 2 hours is enough? See how the enemy wants us? Now, I can sit here. Right here. And not move. And in a few minutes I'll be like this. But when I was out there in the world, I never get like that. And I was jacked up. Huh? I'm jacked up all night. I'm jacked up when I went to the house. I'm jacked up on the jet. Oh, man. I'm feeling that stuff. This is something better than I've ever felt. Why can't we get jacked up on Jesus? Why can't we get the feeling this time? Why can't we get in here and go, man, that something got a hold of me. I don't know what it is. I got a hold of something. It's just got me from my nose to my toes. It's got me so excited. I can't get over it. I can't lay down without thinking about it. It's just getting me on the inside. Oh, preacher, that's religion. No, it ain't. I don't have no religion.
Amen.
I got Jesus, friend.
Amen.
Religion killed Jesus. Huh? God's got a wonderful purpose for you. What is it? Let's look at it. Verses 13 through 16. Well, thou hast possessed my reins. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret, and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. And in thy book all my members were written, which in countenance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. Amen. He's a mighty God, friend.
Amen.
Let me tell you something about you. Listen to me. There's no sin he can't forgive. There's no prayer that he can't answer. There's no soul he can't save. And there's no problem he can't solve. You believe him. And God has you constantly. He has you constantly in his heart. Let's look at verse 17 and 18. How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they are more in number than sand. When I awake, I'm still with thee. That's what he said. That's what he said. There's a little woman one time going to get water in the middle of the day. She took her water pot. She went to the well in the middle of the day. Why did she go to the well in the middle of the day? Women of that culture took their water pot early in the morning to get their water. They didn't go in the middle of the day. Why did this woman go in the middle of the day? She was ashamed, friend. All the other women probably talked about her. All the other people in the village talked about her. You ever heard about the old, how many of you work on cotton mill or have you? Remember they talked about talking around a water cooler? Remember that? Gossiping around a water cooler? Well, she was just tired of being run down. She'd had five husbands. The one she was living with now wasn't her husband. She just had a rough life. She got tired of hearing people run her down. You ever heard people look you in the face and say, you ain't never going to be nothing else. You just going to be like me. Oh, you tried to change before. You went through this whole rigmarole before. You never going to be nothing else than what you are. Your own family look at you and say that. And this woman felt like, you know what? I'm just going to be in this place the rest of my life. So what happens? This American woman, she goes up to the well in the middle of the day, and the worst thing she could ever see was sitting up against the well. Who was it?
Jesus.
Why is that the worst thing she could ever see? All right, let me tell you something. Jews had no dealing with Samaritans. They didn't like them. They didn't deal with them. This woman's walking with a burden on her back. She goes up to the well, and the first thing she sees is Jews. She said, man, I came up here at 12 o'clock to get away from all this gossip. I come up here in the middle of the day to keep being run down. I come up here so I wouldn't be talking about it. And the first thing I run into is a Jew? I don't need this today. And Jesus looked at her and said, you know what? If you drink from this well, you'll thirst again. He said, but if you drink from the water, I'll give you another thirst again. She said, you ain't even got nothing to draw water with. She's thinking the whole time, he's messing with me because I'm a Samaritan, he's a Jew. He's just picking at my head. He's picking on me. She said, you ain't even got nothing to draw water with. I am Lord. You just don't know it. I am that I am. She said, well, let me go get my husband. He said, you do good, so you got a husband. He said, you've had five. And the one you got now ain't your husband. You live with him. He said, wait a minute. I perceive you're a prophet. You tell me everything about my life. What did she do? The Bible said, I want you to understand two things. The Bible said she left her water pot. What was that water pot to her? What is God trying to show us in this scripture? What is he trying to show us? This was her burden, friend. She had a burden that she was bringing up to this well. First thing she did was relieve her burden.
Praise God.
There you go. And the second thing she did, she went to the village of those people that she tried to get away from. Those people talked about her. Those people run her down. God took a woman that had been married five times, living with a man, and made an evangelist out of her. I'm proving to you. You can't fuss against the word of God. I'm proving to you. She ran back to the village. She said, come see a man that's told me everything about my life. that old village. See, me and you say, she was a mess. She can't do this. Her life's like that. 5 times, she can't preach. 5 times, she can't tell nobody about God. Living with a man, she can't. Listen, we go to the Lord to do what? To get straightened out. The Bible clearly tells us, him that knoweth to do good and don't do it, to him it is sin. When you know better, you quit doing it. I tell people at church, give me the drug addict, give me the homosexual, give me the harlot, give me everybody that everybody else don't want. Fill the pew up with them. But I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to tell them what they're doing is right. But I'm going to tell them in a loving way that they've got to come out from among the world and be a separated people, because that's what the Bible said. That's not what I said. He said, without holiness, separation, no man shall see God. When you know better, you don't do it no more. When you know it's sin, you give it up. God didn't cover my sin. He washed my sin away. There's a difference in covering and washing away. They're gone, friend. He don't remember them no more. He's my Savior. He's my guide. He's my counselor. He's the one I'm looking to. You remember the woman at the well. She's in a mess. You come to this place because you was in a mess. I say your life was in a mess. God's given your life. You was in a mess. When you come down here to an altar, God didn't say, I can't straighten you out. No, he didn't. He said, whosoever will, let him come.
Amen.
That means anybody. Whosoever will. Now you started your journey. I went to Jerusalem. I'm going to tell you this. We're going to pray. I went to Jerusalem. You remember in the Bible where he said, if you bring your gift to the altar and you got an altar against your brother, go back and get that all fixed, and then come back and offer you off now. I never knew this, but I went there and I heard the teaching. Do you know that some of those folks, it took them 2 days to get to Jerusalem to offer their gift on the altar? What did that mean when Jesus told them that? That didn't mean just walking across the church and saying, I'm sorry, forgive me. That meant laying your offering down on the altar, walk 2 days back to your village, look at the one you got an awl in the face and say, I'm sorry, will you forgive me? Get forgiveness, turn back around, walk 2 days back to Jerusalem, come back to the altar, and offer up your gift. So it took 6 days to offer up an offer. In our churches, we can't walk across the pew line to go over here and say, I'm sorry. We can't look at the pew behind us and say, you know what, I just wronged you and I'm sorry. Would you forgive me? Until we get to a point that God can do that with us, we're never going to grow. We got to learn to say what? I'm sorry. We got to learn to say, you know what, God, I just messed up. Would you forgive me? And then we got to turn our face back and keep going the way we're going. Because we got our eyes on that. So who are you at tonight? Have you got all in your heart against anybody? Somebody said something to you, made you mad? You got all against them? You say, you know what, preacher, I need to get rid of that. I can't serve God fully until I get rid of that out of my heart. I gotta let it go. I can't fix it. I've tried to fix it. I can't do it. I gotta let it go. Now I want you to help me, God. Forgive that person going. It may be a family member. It may be somebody in the church that you went to. It may be somebody who lives on the corner from you. It may be somebody who lives right beside you. Or it may be somebody you're mocking with. I don't know. But if there's something in your heart that you didn't say, God, I need to get it out. And I need to forgive. I'm going to ask this brother. Come up here and sing one more song with him. And I'm going to open up this altar because I really felt led tonight that we need to work this thing out. Because people, God wants you to move forward. Don't let somebody else get in your way. Don't let what somebody's done to you get in the way. Don't let that person be your God. Because if that's all you think about every day, that person has become a wedge between you and God, and that's become your master. So think about it this minute tonight. Is there anybody that's hindering you to get where God wants you to be? Anybody? As y'all sing, I'm going to open this altar. I want you to come up here and stand tonight. If there's somebody that you need, you know what, I need to forgive them. It may not have been your fault. But let me tell you something. When you're a child of God, you react majestically, not instinctively. You hear me? You react majestically, not instinctively. Stand to your feet all over this place.
No banker can live.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody else? You hold something in your heart?
You
hold something against somebody? Anybody else?
But
the
sin
said,
come so. Hold
the
right away.
What did you say?
For the
God won't give in. Anybody holding you back? Folks, we need to be serious about this thing. You know what the Bible said? If you don't love your brother who you can't see, how can you love God who you can't see? How can you say that?
Don't you gamble on life?
Amen.
All your love.
There's been times in my ministry life, Minister God can't be. There's been times I had to forgive somebody for I'd get a better friend. Somebody say something that would hurt me. I have to give
and say,
God, I'm
going to give it.
Because I didn't know I'm going to give it.
Who is it going to be?
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The sanctified of all you. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Just climb up that mountain.
Oh, yes, Lord. Praise God.
Where's the spring to find?
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
That sparkle
and
grace.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Oh,
hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
harboring here. God, I ask your forgiveness. Take it out. Help me to get past it and be what you have me to be. I'm leaving it at the altar tonight. I'm giving it to you. I'm over it. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you lost nothing done without God, it's easy to pray in this prayer. Father, I'm a sinner. I confess my sin. I ask you to forgive me for my sin. Come into my heart. Save my soul. In Jesus' name. Amen. Nothing no greater to hear that prayer repeated over and over and over again. Feel better about it? Somebody get out of here when they're in. Feel better about it? Go. Praise the Lord, it's gone. Now, we're going to start tonight. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. Right here. We're going to get started. Amen. God bless you. I love you. I appreciate you letting me come out here. I appreciate you listening to me. I appreciate you.